Okay, so our second speaker for this session is Dave Touchette. He's going to talk about also communication complexity, and in particular he's going to focus on quantum information complexity, which is actually a notion for which he's really an expert. He's the one who clarified at least one definition, which seems very elegant for quantum information complexity. What I really like about this paper is that, of course, there are many like technical contributions, but also there's a very nice clarification of some intuitive notions that one might have about the difference between how classical and quantum information behave in interactive protocols. In particular, this idea that classically, when you learn something, in theory, you cannot unlearn it. Whereas quantumly, you can both learn and unlearn information. And as Dave will probably show in this talk, it's quite critical in some quantum protocols. If you want to have protocols with low quantum information complexity, it's critical to actually unlearn some information. So I think it's very nice, and this is a very nice clarification of these ideas. So thank you.
Thanks a lot, Jeremy, for that introduction. Hi, everyone. I'll be discussing some joint work with Mathieu Larrière and Eshwanayak. And well, let me break down the long title in a few parts. So as Jeremy was saying, I'll be talking about interactive quantum communication protocols. In particular, I'll be discussing some new information-theoretic tools to study this protocol, and as well as the application of these tools to, well, both understand a bit more how information flows in such protocols, and also to give more concrete lower bound for both communication complexity and also lower bound in other concrete model of quantum computation. So let me start with a motivating example, that of the disjointness function. So in the disjointness problem, you have two parties, Alice and Bob, who are far apart. Alice given some classical input X, Bob some classical input Y. And you can view these as some subset of a universe of size n. And they want to know whether their set are disjoint or not. Okay. So if you encode these into a bit string of length n, well, another way you can phrase this is that they want to know if there exists some index I for which xi and yi are both equal to 1. Okay. So is there an intersection? And one way to tackle this problem is to implement some distributed version of Grover search. Okay, so in particular, the protocol due to Berman, Cleave, and Wigerson does just that. So let me recap it with you. So given our input X, Alice starts by making the Grover initialization. So she has a register on log n qubit, which she initializes in a uniform superposition over all potential index I for the intersection. And then she wants to implement this oracle call. And to do this, she needs to communicate with Bob. This is the distributed part. So the first thing she do on her side is, well, currently, she will, for any index I, she will also append the bit xi before transmitting both the index register and the bit register to Bob. Then, currently also on this side, Bob can now use these two pieces of information to apply the phase part of the oracle call. Then you transmit that back to Alice, who can now currently erase the XE part. Okay. And then after this oracle call is complete, she can now perform the inversion about the main part. And then they repeat this about square root of n time, as in Grover search. And at the end of this, well, Alice will measure, and hopefully what she will find in the index register is an index where they have an intersection. And if they look up at this index and don't find an intersection, then they say, well, our set are probably disjoint. Okay. So if you account for all communication in this protocol, well, you have log n size communication in each round, square root n round of communication. So up to log term, you have essentially square root n communication. In contrast to the non-lower bound for classical communication for solving this problem, which is linear. Okay. And in fact, this, as Anurag was saying, this quadratic quantum speedup is optimal for disjointness. It was proved by Rasparov that you cannot do better than square root n. And in fact, Anbanias and Aronson showed how you can remove even the logarithmic term to achieve exactly order square root n quantum advantage here. So looking a bit further into this protocol, we might want to know, well, how is information flowing in this protocol? So in particular, how is information flowing about Alice's input x? So Alice is transmitting some information about her input by transmitting this XI information superposition to Bob. And then Bob, after applying his part, is transmitting all of this back. So he's somehow forgetting information about Alice's input, but also transmitting her some information encoded in this phase here. So there's some information about yi in this phase. So how can we precisely assess how information is flowing in this interactive protocol? So, and in particular, well, it might seem that this transmitting back of information or forgetting of information from Bob to Alice might be something which is only wasteful. Like, why would they need to forget this information? Can they do something similar but without having to forget information? So that's the kind of question that motivated our work. So more generally, in this talk, I will be interested in communication complexity settings. So once again, we have Alice and Bob. We are far apart. Alice has input x. Bob has classical input y. And they want to compute some function f of their joint input, x and y. In order to do so, they might pre-share some resources, for example, some pre-share entanglement in our setting. And then once the protocol starts, Alice will compute the first message based on her input x to transmit to Bob, some quantum message, say. Then upon reception of this message from Alice, Bob will act on it, like by looking at what his input y is, apply some operation, transmit some message back to Alice, and so on, back and forth, for some fixed number of rounds. And then at the end, we want Alice to be able to output, at the end of the protocol, the function value evaluated at point x and y with high probability. Okay. So in this communication complexity setting, the main question we're interested in is how much communication is required to be exchanged between Alice and Bob in order to compute function f on input x and y when it is, for example, distributed according to some prior distribution mu. I guess today we'll be taking a more information theoretic view on such protocol and be interested in their information complexity. So instead, the question we're asking is, how much information must Alice and Bob exchange, well, about their, how much information must Alice and Bob leak about their input to each other in order to be able to compute f on input x and y when you measure information according to this prior mu, okay? But then, for information, it's not as clear as for communication. So what's the information content of these interactive protocol? And also, what's the difference between classical information and about information in classical protocol versus information in quantum protocol? These are the kind of questions we'll be studying. So the talk is based on two papers. First one is joint work with Mathieu Larrière about the flow of information in this protocol and what it means, what's the information cost of forgetting in this protocol. This one main takeout message in this work is this exact characterization of how much information is left at the end with each party about the other party's classical input. So we characterize this, we call that like the Olivo information cost, and we show that it's exactly equal to the difference between how much information has been transmitted forward minus how much information has been transmitted back, or how much information has been forgotten. Okay. Whereas in this quantum information cost notion, well, we account for both of these. So we account not only for the cost of transmitting information, but we also add up the cost for forgetting information. The main tool that we use there is what we call the information flow lemma that enables us to characterize exactly this flow of information. And then we use this idea to show that for this disjointness function that we discussed earlier, if a quantum protocol does not forget any information in some specific sense, then we completely lose the quantum speed up. Okay, so any quantum protocol that does not forget information must have linear quantum communication complexity for solving disjointness. And well, another result we obtain is some quantum simulation for a classical protocol that maintains the information cost of the protocol. So yes, the main obstacle we handle there is how to quantumly simulate private randomness without changing the information cost. And then equipped with this, we're asking, well, is there any classical result we can prove with this quantum simulation. And yes, we use this to prove that for a random Boolean function, the classical information cost is essentially n for n plus n random function, on n plus n bit, sorry. And the second word is some joint work with Ashwin Nayak, in which we study the so-called augmented index function, which is a variant on the index function. So you can view Elliot's input as some huge database, and Bob's input as some index pointing into this database, and Bob wants to output at the end like the value of the bit at the ith index, so if he has index I. And then we prove some quantum information lower bound for the augmented index, and use some result due to Magnier's Mathieu and Nayak to level this to a lower bound on quantum streaming algorithm for the so-called DYCK2 function problem, which asks, given some word on two sets of parentheses, is it well-formed? Okay. Some of the tools we use in this work is some generalization of the average encoding theorem in complexity theory, in which we extend it to be able to deal with superposition over inputs, and also some quantum variant of the cut and paste lemma from classical computation complexity. So before I continue, let me state a bit more formally the model that we'll be studying. So once again, for computation complexity, these will be important for us. So given some quantum protocol pi, where Alice is given some input x, Bob some input y, distributed according to some prior mu, they start with some prior entanglement psi. And then once the protocol starts, Alice, based on her input x, will apply some unitary on her share of the pre-shared entanglement, E0, to generate the first message that she will transmit to Bob, the C1 message. Oops, sorry. But she might keep some quantum memory. Let's call it A1 here. Then upon reception of the message, which is transmitted over a noiseless channel, which is received perfectly by Bob, based on his classical input, he will choose which operation to apply on both his share of the entanglement and also on this message to generate a new message to transmit back to Alice, okay? This C2 message. So he can keep some quantum memory B2. Then upon reception, Alice will act on her share of the quantum memory and this new message to generate a third message to send to Bob, and so on, back and forth. And then at the end, Alice has some final register into which she should be able to extract the function value with very high probability. Any question on the specific model? Yes, I'll be carrying along this drawing so that we can refer to it, so no need to memorize all this notation. Then what do we mean by quantum communication complexity for some specific function f? Well, even some function f, we can optimize over all protocols that do compute this function with high probability and take the one that exchange the less amount of communication, okay? So given some specific protocol pi, the quantum communication cost of the protocol is just the sum of the number of qubits in each of these messages, ci. Then we'll also be needing some notion of information. So one most important to us is the conditional quantum mutual information. So let's think of it in this way here. So let's forget down here about this A register for now, and just think about this BC register and this R register. So the conditional mutual information between the C register and this R register conditional on this B register, you can think of as the amount of information this C register contains about this R register from the point of view of someone who already has some side information B. Okay. Then the definition we use is the one based on Neumann entropy. In the classical setting, conditional mutual information, is non-negative, and this follows mostly from definition. Whereas in the quantum setting, it's also non-negative, but it's a deep theorem due to Lieb and Roskay. Another important property that we use a lot in this interactive setting is the so-called chain rule for mutual information that we can use to break the mutual information between the BD system and the A system into a B part and a D part separately. It's also well-behaved information measure in the sense that, it's invariant under local isometric operation. It satisfies some data processing inequality and so on. And in order to define the quantum information complexity, we'll make use of one operational interpretation due to DEFTAC and YARD of conditional mutual information, which is in the setting of a quantum set distribution. So, okay, good. So if you think about any three-party quantum system on system A, B, C, can purify it into some, let's call it reference register R. Then if at the beginning, Alice is starting with this AC register, Bob is starting with this B register, we can ask in the asymptotic limit, and when we allow for free entanglement, what's the optimal rate of communication Alice and Bob must exchange in order to transfer this C system from Alice to Bob. Okay. And it turns out that this is equal to the conditional mutual information between the C system and the R system, conditioned on the B system. And one last information-theoretic tool I'll define before I go in on is this recent inequality due to fuzzy runner, which states, gives some interpretation of conditional mutual information in terms of recovery operation. Okay. So once again, if you have these R, B, C, and R system, what the theorem says is that if you throw this C system into the garbage can, there should exist some recovery map that acts only on the B system, but maintain correlation about the R system, such that you can recreate the C system. And if you have low mutual information, then the distance between the recreated state and the original state should be small. Okay, so on to definition of quantum information complexity. So once again, if you want to compute the quantum information complexity for a specific function f, you can just optimize over all protocol that computes function f with small error and take the one that leaks the least amount of information. Okay? But then how do you quantify this amount of information? I guess we can motivate the following definition by thinking in terms of state distribution in the following way. So if you take a cut at each of these messages here in the protocol, you have these three registers, like the communication register, the side information on Alice's side, and the side information on Bob's side. So since these operations are all isometric, all these registers are purified by just taking the purification of the classical input here. That's what I mean by this Rx and Ry register, which are just two current copies of X and Y. And then quantifying information as in state redistribution, the quantum information complexity for such a protocol would be just the sum of these terms. So for these odd messages from Alice to Bob, the information content of message CI about this purification register conditional on Bob's side information, and for messages from Bob back to Alice, we're measuring how much information these messages contain about the purification register conditional on Alice side information. But then, yes, this has some nice property in particular. Well, the motivation for the definition through state distribution gives us that, it satisfies the property that this measure of information is equal to amortized communication in the sense that what's the least amount of communication you need to simulate these this protocol in the asymptotic limit. It's also an additive measure in the sense that if you want to measure the quantum information complexity for computing function 1 and function 2 in parallel, then this is exactly equal to the quantum information complexity for computing the first function plus the quantum information complexity for the second function. It's a direct lower bound on communication, and it's also a continuous relaxation of these communication measure. Okay. But then it's also unsatisfying in the following sense. So if we have classical inputs and we require to pass through this purification of the classical input, then, well, it's not clear what information about what we're measuring here. Okay, so it's still nice information measure in the sense that it satisfies this information equal amortized communication property. But then, yeah, so with this definition based on purification of the classical input, we don't really know about what we're measuring information. Okay, so a potential alternative for this definition might be to just try to measure the final information that Alice and Bob each have about their respective inputs. So that's what we term the all-level information cost. Okay, so we can just look from Bob's perspective. So how much all-level information he has in the end about Alice's input, plus how much all-level information Alice has in the end about Bob's input. And if you compare this to the notion of information cost that's widely accepted in the for classical protocol, well, formally they just look the same. So in the classical setting, the final information is just, well, the sequence of classical messages, which are exchanged back and forth. Okay, these are classical messages, so Alice and Bob can just keep copy of each of them. And formally, these things look the same. But then, if you try to view this as a complexity measure, so if you have given some function f, if you optimize over all protocols that compute f, this information measure, well, it's trivial in the following sense. So you can just think of Alice transmitting her all input to Bob. Then Bob can compute the function value, make a copy of this function output, and then apply the, since quantum computing is reversible, you can just erase all your workspace, transmit back Alice's input to her, and then the only workspace you're left with at the end is the one containing your function output. Okay, so if you have Boolean function, well, this complexity measure is bounded by one. So you don't really want this. Okay. But then instead, well, we might try to only measure the new amount of classical information that each message contains, okay? And this is the approach that Kiridinis, Loria Legal, and Renola took, motivated by privacy concern. So I define the, what they call classical input information cost in the following way. So for the messages from Alice to Bob, you look how much new information CI contains about Alice's input from Bob's point of view. So you condition on what he has. And for messages from Bob back to Alice, you measure how much information each message CI contains about Bob's input from the point of view of Alice, who already knows like the information in X and AI. Okay. And then, well, you can also contrast this to the classical notion of information costs, and you just apply a chain rule on this. And what you get is something that looks formally the same, once again. So how much new information each new classical message reveal about the other party's input, conditioned on what you already know, which is like the sequence of message that you already receive. Okay. And then you can see that the following links should hold. So the amount of information that you have at the end is upper bounded by the sum of the new amount of classical information you learn in each messages, which in turn is upper bounded by, well, the amount of communication that you need to simulate this in the asymptotic limit, the SQIC notion. But we couldn't help but feel that there should be some deeper relationship here. And the approach we took to study this relationship is through this information flow lemma, which says the following. So from Bob's point of view, we can characterize how much information he has at the end of the protocol minus how much information he had at the beginning, which you can just view as, well, this is the final level of information that he has. This is exactly equal to the sum of the new information he learns from each of Ali's messages. But then you need to subtract how much information he's forgetting when he's transmitting back messages to her. Okay. So then how can we make the link between all these notions of information cost? Well, you can use the chain rule and duality of conditional mutual information to rewrite this QIC notion in the following way. So for each messages, you add up how much information this message contained about Alice's input from Bob's point of view, plus how much new information about Y's input contained from Alice's point of view. Okay, so it looks similar to this CIC notion, but then you also have all these extra terms. Okay, so for example, if you take a message from Alice to Bob here, well, this accounts not only for how much information the message contains about Alice's input, but for this message from Alice to Bob, it also accounts for how much information about Bob's input Alice is learning, or something else, okay? So if you encapsulate all these extra terms into this, well, class called input, reverse information cost, quantifying like the amount of information flowing in the reverse direction, okay, so how much, it just adds all the information messages from Bob to Alice contain about Alice's input and vice versa. And we can apply the information flow lemma to rewrite the following thing. Okay, so the final amount of information is exactly equal to the amount of information transmitted forward minus how much has been forgotten. Okay, this QRC is, we can make sense of as the amount of information that's been forgotten. Whereas the quantum information cost just accounts for these two in a positive way. Okay, so we just add them up. We account not only for information flowing forward, but also for information flowing backward. And since this quantity also quantifies like amortized communication, it makes sense that you have to pay not only for information flowing forward, but also for information being forgotten. And then, yeah, this cost of forgetting, this CRIC term, exactly assess the backflow of information. And one additional advantage of this this new characterization is that, well, we don't need to pass through this notion of purification of classical input anymore. We can just think of the total amount of information flowing in the protocol as how much information flowing forward and how much information flowing backward. Second tool that we develop is called superposition average encoding theorem, which is a generalization of the average encoding theorem in complexity theory. So let me just recap this average encoding theorem version first due to Clock, Nayak, Teschmann, Zuckerman. So if you start with some class called quantum state on register X and B, if these register X and B are weakly correlated, then what the average encoding theorem tells you is that, well, in fact, each encoding of X into this B system is on average close to the average encoding, which is just, yeah, the average state here. Okay, so we measure here this distance in terms of resistance, like H squared is equal to 1 minus the fidelity. It's essentially follow from Pinsker's inequality. And it has found many applications. And for example, you can use it together with a round by round variant of something like the all over information cost to prove a bounded round quantum communication complexity lower bound for disjointness, as in the paper due to Jane, Reddick, Christian, and Sam. Oh, thanks. But then this worked well when we have class called register X. But then what happens if we have a superposition over over register X or over part of it? So this happens often in so-called direct sum argument. So one way we found to handle such a case is by applying the fuzzy render inequality that I stated earlier. So let me just recap it quickly. Now in terms of this Bayes distance, h. So it says that there should exist a recovery map such that if you trace out the communication system and apply this recovery map on bob side information, you should be able to recover the BNC system while maintaining correlation with the purification system. Okay. And yeah, so on average, this distance is upper bounded by the mutual information, conditional mutual information. So let me try to state the theorem in graphical terms. It says the following. So if the following condition is satisfied, so for each odd I, like the information of the message from Alice to Bob, CI, contains about RX, RI from Bob's point of view, is small enough, epsilon I, in the following way, so that like the total number of messages times the sum of all the information cost for these messages. If this is small enough, then, well, essentially, Bob can just disregard Alice messages and generate himself the final state of the protocol in the following sense. So if you view this final state of the protocol on Bob's final register, also take into account Bob's input and the purification of both the input of Alice and Bob. And you compare this to something where Bob only acts locally on his information. So he just, instead of waiting for Alice messages, he applied the fuzzy render recovery map. Each time he should receive a message from Alice, then continue the protocol, generate the next message by applying the next fuzzy render map and so on. Then the state you generate in the end should be close enough to the actual final state of the protocol. And finally, the last tool I wish to talk about is what we call the quantum content paste lemma. This is a variant of a tool that was developed by Jane Radhakrishnan and Sen, and also by Jen and Iyak. And it says the following. So if you fix your quantum communication protocol, but you only consider a small subset of input, okay, so a 2x2 rectangle. So Alice has two potential input, x1 and x2. Bob has two potential input, y1 and i2. Then the condition we consider are the following. So if you fix the input of Bob, say to y1, and you vary Alice's input from x1 to x2, and after receiving each of Alice's message, like you don't change the state on Bob's side by much by varying Alice's input. So that's what this term quantify here. And similarly, if also something similar all on Alice's side. So if you fix Alice's input to x1, and you look at what happened on her side, like what their state looked like, as you vary Bob's input from y1 to y2, and it doesn't change much. Well, by using the protocol structure here, on top of these two conditions, well, you can argue something about what happened when, instead of having x1 here, you replace this by x2, okay? So instead of having x1 here, if instead you have x2 now and you vary the input on Bob's side, then it's still close in the end. And then the closeness will depend on all these previous terms on both Alice and Bob's side. So let me take a few minutes to discuss application of this tool. Oh, good, thanks. And we have 5 minutes left, so I already discussed the Disjointness quite a bit, so let me skip on to maybe the streaming algorithm lower bound for DYCK2. So recall that this DYCK2 problem is the following. So you have two sets of parentheses, and you wonder whether, given some input, it's a well-formed expression over these two parentheses. Okay. And we wish to prove some lower bound on any quantum streaming algorithm which decides this problem. Okay. And our approach is inspired by that of Magnaïs, Mathieu, and Nayak, which is done in two steps. Okay. So the first one is to perform some reduction from a multi-party quantum communication complexity problem to a streaming algorithm for this. And well, the reduction between these two models goes as follows. So you can think of streaming algorithm quantum setting as follows. So you first initialize some register. So say your algorithm works with space n, depending on the length of your input. Initialize this to some fixed quantum state. And then, well, you pass this. So you pass over your input. And as you go, depending on what your classical input is, you apply some quantum operation, depending on this, so on. So you can make a first pass over your input, x1 up to xn. And then here we consider t-pass one-way quantum streaming algorithm. So after you do a first pass, you can then go back to the beginning, make another pass, and so on. And then, well, what's the link with multi-party quantum communication complexity? Well, it's a bit more complicated than this, but at the high level, it looks like this. So if instead you take the same drawing and you view this as, well, this is the input to a first party, x2 is the input to a second party, and so on, then you can just, to solve your multi-party communication problem, you can have the first party initialize the register here and then start applying the streaming algorithm. And then what's the communication? Well, the communication is just the workspace used in the quantum streaming algorithm. Okay. And then these authors found a very clever reduction, like they found a subset of instances that makes the mapping between some problem, which is a big OR of multiple instances of a two-party problem. So that's the approach we took too. And then in order to go from this multi-party problem, which is a bit harder to tackle, to a two-party problem, well, they use some so-called direct sum argument to reduce this to a two-party problem. And I guess, whereas here, you only require a quantum communication lower bound to get a space lower bound, yes, to apply this direct sum argument, that's where information comes in. So then to reduce from multi-party to two-party and still get a lower bound, you need an information lower bound at this point. And moreover, you need it on an easy distribution in the following sense. Yes. So the two-party problem is augmented index, which is a variant of the index problem. So 2 minutes, thanks. This index problem, call is this, you can view as follows. So Alice has some big database, and Bob is given some index, and you wish to extract the value of the ith bit in Alice's database. And this augmented variant, well, Alice is still given some big database, but then Bob's given some additional information. Okay, so he's given the value of all the bit for index lower than the one he's looking for. And then this easy distribution is just a uniform distribution, but over the zeros of this function. And then the trade-off that we prove is that, in fact, for any protocol that's successfully solved this augmented index problem, either Bob has to reveal a non-trivial amount of information about this index to Alice, or else Alice needs to reveal a non-trivial amount of information but about each of her coordinates to Bob. Okay. And I guess the approach we take builds on the one of Jane and Nayak here. And where you're using the tool that we developed, so this superposition average encoding theorem, quantum quartet paste. And then get some improved parameter by also using this information flow lemma here. So let me conclude on this. So we developed some new information theoretic tool to study these interactive quantum protocol. So this information flow lemma, superposition, Erge encoding theorem, and we abstract out this quantum content based lemma. And we found some interesting application for this tool. And well, hopefully, we'll find further application together with you guys. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Yes.
So you mentioned that if for the disjointness, if you do not forget information, then the communication complexity is n.
Right.
Is it a general feature of any other function, or is something specific to disjointness, you believe?
Yes. We don't know yet. Okay. So the structure of the disjointness function makes it so that it's this way. And yes, the how we can prove it, well, it builds on. Let me try to find this line. Okay. So it builds on this proof approach that we had last year to prove an almost optimal lower bound for the bounded round quantum communication complexity disjointness with Berman, Enkit, Garg, Yangoku, and Jamie Mao. And I guess how the number of rounds came into play in this proof is essentially through some continuity argument that appears in the proof. And this continuity argument you can view off as, well, it doesn't arrive in the classical setting, and why it can arise in quantum setting is because, well, you can transmit back and forth the same information, more or less, in the quantum setting. So if you don't allow for this forgetting of information, then you get around. Pardon?
It behaves like classical.
Yeah, in a sense. But yeah, no, so it might not be a general feature.
Thanks.
But, yeah.
You get a t-shirt for your question. Maybe it will motivate further questions, even though I'm not sure I can distribute t-shirts for any question.
You've mentioned an application to the JRS approach. Can you say a bit more about that?
Which one, pardon? So you mean...
In theorem one. At the end. No, at one. Yes, so the cost of forgetting.
Yes.
But so you've mentioned an application to the JRS approach with the...
Do you mean the average encoding theorem or trying to...
Yes, I think.
Or maybe linking with the notion of information that...
Yes.
This. Mm-hmm. So are you talking about the paper for bounded round quantum communication complexity of disjointness?
Yes.
Yeah, so...
Exactly.
I guess you can also relate this notion of QIC with this notion of... The notion of information that they use is somewhat similar to the yellow information cost that I discussed here, but they have a round-by-round variant. So in each round, they count the total yellow information that, say, Bob has about Ali's input, and so on. And since we have an exact equality here instead of just an inequality, then we can use the other direction, say, to relate also to their notion, but up to a factor of number of rounds, I guess. So. Since if you recount in each round the total amount of information, it could be that, say, in the first round, you're transmitting a lot of information, and then you transmit almost no information in later round. But then you just recount this information each time by counting each time. Okay. But.
Yeah, I think I'll ask you a bit more offline.
Okay, yeah, sure.
Any other question? No? Okay, maybe I have one question, which is a very high-level question and maybe naive, but I was always wondering. when you look at the definitions of quantum information complexity and classical information complexity, there's a very important difference is that in the case of quantum information complexity, you need to have a definition that, is round by round. You have a sum over all rounds, which is not the case in for classical information complexity, right, at least in the standard definition. Of course, you can decompose it into round by round sum, but you don't have to. So I was wondering whether it's clear that you have to do that in the quantum case. Of course, I understand that one reason is that you don't have any notion of transcript in the quantum case.
Right.
But is it clear to you that it's really necessary to have a definition which involves a sum over all rounds? Or is there a way to avoid this and have a nice, like, one-term definition?
I guess it's not clear yet. And one reason why I think it might be possible is because another paper due to this set of author, Jane Radhakrishnan and Sen, use a different, yet another different notion of information in which like they're able to have a meaningful notion of information, which is not round by round, but for product distribution only though. So if you have a product distribution, then you can somehow take some variant of this all of information cost notion where you measure how much information Bob has at the end about the list input. But you put like the purification of Bob's register, of Bob's input register, together with it. Okay, so if you also take into account this, like it's somehow analogous to allowing Bob to start over a superposition of his input instead of a distribution. And then they can use this to prove, for example, compression results. So they can show then that for product distribution, the amount of communication to simulate your protocol is at most 2 to this notion of information, which is then upper bounded by this notion of QIC. So is there something similar for non-product distribution as a case? And well, also only for product distribution, how far can you push this definition due to GRS? But a very, very nice question. Thanks.
OK, great. Thanks. I see one maybe last question there. There's a microphone coming.
Oh, yeah. Oh, thanks. Sorry. I'm confused about the last, your very last answer, because if you have two-way communication, then you can always just copy the answer, uncompute everything.
Right.
So how do you, like, how can you measure anything? Like, if you can do that, then what can you meaningfully say without looking at the intermediate states? Or is it just, so this it just applies to one-way communication that you can do the non, or, yeah, what?
No, no, so I guess, for example, one example I have in mind is that for inner product. Okay, so one of the early proof for quantum communication complexity of the inner product function being linear is that, well, you just run your protocol forward, copy the output, and then encode it in the phase, then erase that, run the protocol backward, and then it seems that what you have left is only this one bit of information. Encoded in the phase, moreover. But then if you give access to this purification register to Bob, then he can just extract all of Alice's input. Okay? So even though it seems that you only have like this one bit of information at most, somehow hidden there is like this n bit of information. So, but yeah, I guess for non-product distribution, it's probably harder to believe that things like that might be going on. Thanks. Next question.
Okay, I think we have to stop here. So let's thank both speakers of this session again. And let's have a break. And
this
is for you.
Great, thanks.